Why is the wow so important? Why is the wow so important? Well, at the last minute, we pivot our attention off of the trouble and we realize that we did it. Extraordinary, right? The shock of success is extraordinary. That's where the wow comes in. So right away we realize our success and we go right into the wow. Wow. We don't define it. You see, we don't struggle with explanation or definition or concepts or causation or effects or any of that. There's no struggle. It precludes struggle. So when we pivot off of the struggle, the last thing we want to do is to go back into the struggle, right? It's all about pivoting off of the struggle. Without going back into the struggle. So we pivot off and we know, oh, okay, wow. Wow covers it all. So wow is the way. The new way is wow, without any doubt about it. Pivoting off of the struggle is exactly what will take place for those of us who've practicing the wow. Otherwise, when we will, before we pivot off the struggle, we'll say, well, how can I handle the success of doing this? How can I define it? How will I be able to? And the struggle continues and no pivot off of the struggle takes place. But confidence in the wow, you say, okay, I can do this. So just before taping, this was the perfect example. And last night, another perfect example. This morning, another perfect example. I've been following the 2017 Open Championships, a golf championship in England, a little bit online, just checking the scores every day. And my guy, Jordan Spieth, has been leading pretty much the whole way. And it's the last round now, and I'm online checking the scores and the blog, the live blog, and then it says you can watch live online for a little bit. They allow you to watch live. I don't turn on the TV, so I'm not going to watch it on TV. I said maybe I can escape the commercials. No, I cannot. It's a live feed from the network, so you get all the commercials. I said, uh-oh, this isn't good. So Spieth and Kuchar are tied for the lead going into the final holes here. And I think it's on 13, Spieth sprays his tee shot 100 yards wide right, and it's unplayable lie. He takes an unplayable lie. He has to drop in on the driving range. He has to move. His vision is obstructed. It takes a half an hour to play the hole. It's like super dramatic. somehow he manages to escape with a bogey, and he falls one behind, and so it's getting real dramatic. The next hole, par three, what's he do? He almost aces the hole. He almost aces it and knocks in for birdie, tied for the lead. Next hole, they both drive off on the 15th in the fairway. And what do I do? Because now the drama is absolutely thick. The struggle, the drama, it is all going to culminate in the next four holes, 15, 16, 17, and 18. And I've been following this for like, this is the fourth day. So what do I do? What do I do? Well, this commercial comes on. Car commercial. And I'm hearing that, and I say, uh-oh. Right. And the message of that and everything resonates so terrible to me. It's so terrible, the message, how commercials are and the way that they try to craft your mind, etc. I say, wow, I'm not watching that. That's it. And right away, I click, close the internet connection and walk out here and say, let's start taping now. So I completely pivoted off all the drama. Wow, you see? And so I won't be watching. I won't follow what happens. I'll be taping here, explaining the wow and emphasizing it. So just when I thought I was going to be pulled in to the struggle and the drama, something really, really turned me off to it, right? That commercial. I said, well, this is what they're trying to get your attention so caught up in the drama, and then they want to slip this psychology into you with the commercial. I said, that's how it works. You see, television is all about drama, the struggle, the fear, the emotionalism, and then this slick, sleazy, you know, psychological ploy that the advertisers use. They're very, very adept at what they do. And but right away I said, wow, I'm not going to let that into my mind, no way. So, save me. Wonderful. The world is so awful, it saves us. You see, this is the great thing about the world right now. It's so terrible. It's so terrible that it's giving us tremendous opportunity to pivot off of drama, of drama, of struggle, of effort. So really, the world is not, quote unquote, it's so bad, it's good, you know. This is what we have to recognize. The world is so bad, it's wonderful. It gives us such a great opportunity here. It's wonderful. Wow. So, don't bemoan the world. Thank the world. Say, thank you, world, for being so absolutely terrible that I'm finally able to pivot off into the wow of being able to do that. To pivot off the world. You pivot into the wow of being able to do this. If we don't have the wow, we pivot off the world. We say, oh my gosh, I did it. Hey, everybody, I did it. I don't know, what do I do now? You know, how did I do that? And we're still right in the drama and the struggle. So, we pivot off the world into the wow. Pivoting into the wow. Off the world and into the wow. We pivot off the world and into the wow. Not into some other result. Okay. First, the wow. Okay. Ultimately, it's kind of like pivoting out of the darkness into the dawn. Let's say one direction we're looking is still pitch dark, and we pivot to where the sun is rising, the dawn. And it's like, oh my gosh, out of the darkness and into the dawn, we're pivoting. But instead of saying, oh, it's the dawn, oh, wow, you know, we say just, wow, I pivoted. We understand we've pivoted into the dawn, but we really pivoted into the wow, first and foremost. The dawn will take care of itself. As long as we're facing in the right direction, yeah, we're going to see the light, aren't we? So we don't have to try to define that. We just stay in the wow. Happened last night to me. Out of the blue, out of nowhere, suddenly this inner recognition took place. And I said, wow. So instead of trying to define what took place or to struggle to clarify it, I now know I have pivoted into the right direction. You see, that's what's important. So facing the light of truth, but I'm not really focused on it. I'm focused on the wow. Wow, I did it. And just stay right in that. Truly the key to success. So I tried not to define it, not to struggle with it. Got up this morning, got a nice, pretty good rest. Got up in the morning, okay. Did I try to remember what happened? No, I said, no. Wow. I pivoted into the wow. But really, there was this recognition. Out of the blue. I mean, just out of nowhere. And nothing that I had ever seen or done or read spiritually. 50 years of intense spiritual study and effort. And none of that study or effort had prepared me for what I saw. Isn't that extraordinary? But what prepared me was the wow practice. That's what prepared me to see it. All of the millions of words that I've read and the concepts and the study and reading, you know, all these spiritual books and studying them for 40 years and then, none of that actually prepared me at all for what I saw. But the wow did prepare me for it. And so instead of saying, well, how in the world, why, how did I get that insight? You know, how did that happen? I don't understand the study that I've been doing. How did that lead to this? And, you know, trying to establish a chain of causation and everything. I just said, wow. So extraordinary. When I say out of the blue, it means it didn't seem to have any correlation with anything at all I've been doing, except I have been practicing in a certain way, very diligently, affirmations and wow. But I don't know how the affirmations worked exactly, but they did. Because I had faith that they would. I had faith that they would pivot me in the right direction. And it did. But in pivoting me in the right direction, then I saw clearly. And I said, okay. Duh. That's it. Okay. Wow. So I'm facing the right direction now. But not really paying attention to what's there at this point. I'm paying attention to wow. This is the discipline. The answer's right there, but it's so shocking because I cannot establish how it is that I overlooked this for my whole life and how it is that I stopped overlooking it, you see. If we get into that, immediately we're spinning this massive web of confusion for ourselves. So we forego all of that and we just say, wow. Now, what's happened with me the last week is I started going back to my old ways, sort of like bit by bit. I could tell I was starting to slide. And But also I could feel there was a tremendous pressure, some inner pressure that was taking place. And so I was also practicing very intensely. Both were going on. I'm getting really bored. I say, what do? My life, I have no direction. I don't know this and this and that. Then suddenly, out of nowhere, this comprehensive recognition took place. And so I'm just wowing that. The power of wow, actually, is what it's really about. That's the real power. I had gone back and I was sort of looking back to some of the various teachings that I discarded previously. Said, no, that's not it, that's not it, that's not it. I looked back and I saw that and I read it and I said, well, it sounds good, but I said, you know what, it's still not it. That is still not it. All the non-dual teachings and these teachings of the past, I said, that's still not it. It's not it. And I really felt that it's missing it. It's still missing the whole thing. It is. You know, there's no I, there's no person, there's no one to experience, there's the blah, 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 blah. That's still just words. It's missing it entirely, actually. It's missing it entirely, is how I felt. Entire miss. Truth cannot be expressed. Cannot be expressed. You cannot express it in non-duality. You can only say what it's not, actually, but that's still not it, you see. We can only say what it's not. We say no I, this, it's, and there's no I. We're still saying what it's not. But what it actually is, we cannot explain or express. So this is how I felt. I said, you cannot, all that stuff is just useless. It's really useless. I had this feeling that all teaching is useless. It's practice. Practicing the wow is where it's really at. The patience and the practice of wow. The affirmations are very helpful too. Certain affirmations will arise and you realize this will be helpful. I had faith in this. I had a lot of faith. I said, I feel this is going to do it for me. I had this affirmation I've been doing last week. And I said, I feel this is going to do it for me. I had this very strong feeling. But once it works, what then? Wow, you see. So wow is really the core. Not all this non-dual talk about, you know, all the stuff that they say. As intriguing as it is to our mind, to the ego, you know, it's like, oh, this is some drama to follow here. It's useless. And even to talk about how useless it is useless as well. If we don't practice the wow. The wow is useful. Okay, the wow has true usefulness. It's truly utilitarian. It's the ultimate in that. Now, it's super important that we have just one utilitarian tool left. Okay, when we realize realization is what? The result is inexpressible. We can say a little bit something about it, but to have this one utilitarian tool that we hold on to and we feel this is useful. Okay. Because what happens or should we say what happens at this point? Maybe not. Maybe not. So you have to go on faith. I don't want to give you something to grab a hold of and start thinking about. because then we're in the same old trap. And I can say that it's faith that works. It's faith in, for instance, the affirmations I was making, the assertions. Very simple. I kept doing it and doing it and doing it. Kept pivoting my attention off of whatever I was thinking, and to do this practice throughout the day. Just kept doing it. And I kept saying, well, why am I doing this? This isn't gonna work. I said, I have faith, I feel, because the Holy Spirit gave this to me when I had some very key recognition. It said, do this. So I just did it. I didn't ask why, because I said, I have faith, this is going to work. I didn't try to think about why is it working, because then it wouldn't have worked. Then I wouldn't have been doing it. Instead of doing the practice, I'd be thinking, well, why does this practice work? That's not doing it. And so we have to pivot off of the thinking, even the highest thinking, and do the practice. Even if you're thinking of what you think, the belief, what we believe is to be the most important thinking we can do, still we have to pivot off of that and just do the assertion, just assert it very clearly. Like that. And what it does, it affects us on a very, very deep, in a deep way. Right to the heart of the issue. But superficially, our thinking doesn't see that at all. So it cannot see the heart of the issue. So it cannot understand how this could be helping. So it thinks it can help it along by thinking about it and trying to explain it. That just gets in the way. Just gets in the way. So pivot off of your thinking, even if the thinking seems to be extremely profound. Pivot off of that onto your practice. So this practicing I was doing, then suddenly, out of nowhere, it just this flashed through my mind. I just saw this. Oh, wow. And I had never seen this before. And all the spiritual study I've done in my life had never pointed this out before, actually, what I saw. Now, surely, there are those who have pivoted their attention in the right way, but it seems to be somewhat unique to each one of us exactly how we experience this recognition, and it doesn't seem to be, we really cannot convey it to others. You cannot. So that's the thing. I've been studying my whole life to try and understand what is it that they saw. You know, what is it, this breakthrough, and yet, no matter how much I've studied, spent my whole life doing this, it was not properly conveyed to me. It was all a waste of time. If I had just practiced with faith, what the Holy Spirit told me to practice, and then practiced the wow for the success, I wouldn't have had to gone through all that wastage of time. All that waste. That's why someone like Ram Maharshi will just say, just do the practice. It'll work for you. Have faith that it'll work for you. They don't try to explain why it will work. That's the trap. So it boils down to your faith and your resolve to do it. And the more there are of us who say, just do this practice, it will work. And I'm adding this wow, which I feel is all important. Because you see it works, you say, but wait a minute. Okay, now what teaching did I study that caused this to work? Or it's like, no, don't go there. Don't go there. Don't go there at all. No teaching worked for you. Okay, the assertions that the Holy Spirit told you to do is what works. So you just have to listen to the Holy Spirit and do what it tells you to do. That's what I did. So I condition myself in the right way. So suddenly this recognition could take place. I said, oh. Wow. So that's the real drama, is what's taking place here. This is the true drama, and we have to handle it by, wow, this is an extraordinary drama. The problem is, as soon as if I explained it, then the mind automatically says, okay, now where did this come from, and what kind of teaching, right, you know, and it goes like that. And then everything falls apart on you. And we think, well, I don't have this problem. Oh, yes, we do. Oh, yes, we do. The most severe problem. It's like I had been blind my entire life. I have been blind to what I was doing. No matter what I studied spiritually, I was still blind to it. So we have to have faith that we have this fundamental blindness to what our trouble is. And we have to work at a deeper, in a deeper way than trying to understand. And this is what the great sages have always taught, said, right? But in this information age, we have been tricked out of this. This is the great wickedness of the age that we live in. Extremely wicked age. What have we lost in all our information age? What have we thrown by the wayside? Faith is what we've thrown by the wayside. Faith in the Holy Spirit. And we say, well, we don't need that. We have computers now. We have smartphones. We can Google something. We don't need the Holy Spirit. This is the extreme wickedness of these times. So what I did is the Holy Spirit, I had this tremendous depth recognition. Out of that, then this practice occurred to me, to practice like this. And so I started practicing that way. And I just had this feeling of faith that somehow this would resolve what I had seen. I'd seen this sort of, can't really explain it, but I felt like this practice is going to really ultimately resolve it. But I cannot explain how. It's too deep for that. It's too deep. I cannot get my mind there in an explanatory way as I go about my life. It's not possible. It's not possible. As we go about our busy days, it's not possible to have the kind of focus that I was able to attain there for just a little bit, where I was able to really see very, very deeply. So that goes away. But a practice occurred to me, and I can practice it constantly as I'm going about my day. And I said, this will absolutely is the right practice to resolve what I saw. So let me just keep practicing, keep pivoting off my mind stream, keep pivoting off of that onto an assertion. Now, I don't need to say what my assertion is, because each one of us needs to go through this and listen to the Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit suggest? Each one of us is unique in our approach. Okay, unique. And we have to feel like it comes from within, from the Holy Spirit. The practice is being suggested by the Holy Spirit. The one exception to that is the wow practice. That's the one exception, we would say. Because this is fundamentally pragmatic, that we have to manage our success. This is a given. So this one utilitarian issue has to be accepted here. But as far as what your assertion is going to be, and how you recognize, etc., that needs to be up to you and the Holy Spirit. So the ego is telling me, well, explain. If you want to teach, explain. And I say, no, that's all up to you, except just the one explanation I'll give is, well, wow. And, the ego will say, okay. You have one, that's okay. It calms it all down. We feel like, well, you can't just give no explanation. And I say, yeah, because that creates this feeling of it's too difficult. It's unfairly difficult. So we do give the one explanation, the wow explanation. But the rest will arise within you as you're willing to wow it, your success. Then it will occur. The insights will occur, the deep recognitions will occur, a practice will occur to you, say, hey, just if I just practice this way, I feel that this is really going to help. This is really going to help a lot more than I can explain. Don't try to explain how it can help. It's going to be more profound than you realize, for sure. So don't even think about results. Just do the practice. That's the other key. Do not aim for any results. Just simply do it with faith. Now, I was starting to wonder, like, where are the results? You know, I've been doing this quite a bit. And I was kind of starting to flag, kind of lag a little bit, saying, wow, I don't know, is this going to work? And then suddenly, this recognition took place. So it did work. But there will be this feeling at some point, like, is this really going to work? Should I stop? Is this all a wild, putting my faith in something that doesn't work, etc.? That always will try to arise and just pivot off of that and just practice again. So I preconditioned myself to succeed by this, the assertion I was making. Preconditioned myself to success, and then it occurred, and then I wowed the success. So it's like you precondition yourself to expect success, it occurs, and then you wow the success. That's the entire dynamic here. That's it. So is Spieth winning, or is Kuchar winning, or is something else happening? I don't know. But I know that we're winning right here, and that's what's important. See, it's all about us winning. Right? Each one of us. We want to win. We're in it to win it. We're in it to win it. There's that song, Amazing Grace. I was blind, but now I see. That's what they're talking about. Amazing grace is amazing. That somehow the grace of God has suddenly removed the blindness from us. This is a faith-based culture works. Faith-based culture works. Meaning faith in the grace of God to remove the blindness from us. Truly, we are blind. Psychologically blind. We're blind to what we're doing. We're blind to our blindness, you might say. We're blind to our blindness. Absolutely. And when the recognition takes place, it's like blindness has been removed from you. But right away, you go right to the wow. Wow, blindness has been removed from me. Wow. Don't think ahead. And don't think behind. Just say, well, I've got this utility of wow, and I'm using it. So you have this tool, useful tool, and you're using it. So you feel fine about yourself. See, panic comes in when we say, well, where's my tool? I don't know how to use it. I'm not sure what to do. I'm not sure. But we say, no, I have my tool. It's wow, and I know how to use it by stating wow, staying in the wow. And so you feel calm. You feel calm. Even though you're in shock, you still feel calm. There's no panic. We don't realize how we've drifted away from faith-based, grace-based culture. We don't realize that. It's really been a free fall away from it. And really a free fall away from success. And that's never a good thing. There's this dead branch on this tree that's been there for so long. And yesterday I finally said, you know what? I grabbed a saw and started sawing on it. And it was very difficult because it was really high up and it has reach really high. And I was like, oh, man, it took me quite some time. But finally, boom, it fell. the dead branch is gone. Amazing. It was right here, right to the side of the taping, and now it's open. There's no deadness there at all. No deadness there at all. Wow. And I just felt like I had the strength to do it. I had never done it before. Why? Why did I wait so long? Maybe I just felt like I had the strength to do it. Something gave me a push also. Circumstances gave me a push to do it. There's a lot of cleanup going on around here. There was a bunch of circumstances that took place. And suddenly I was inspired and said, hey, why don't I also do some cleanup and cut this tree limb? It's obviously dead and it's been there for quite some time. Why don't I just do it? So I started and I said, oh, wow, this is more difficult than I thought. I don't even know if I'm going to be able to do it. I came at it from different angles. And suddenly, boom, that was it. It fell off. So it was a combination of being in very good shape, circumstances inspiring me, the right moment, the opportune moment, and, you know, seize the moment, and then was determined to not fail. I was determined to not fail. I had to do this. I had to move something out of the way, which I did. And so it's like that for us. To succeed, we need to keep on working out, practicing, building up the wow, the confidence in it all, in ourselves and in faith. Doing the best we can every single day. And then at some moment, circumstances and your resolve will coalesce at the right moment, and you will get it done. Now, am I looking there where the dead branch used to be? No. I'm ignoring it basically for now. I'm in the wow. So this is the key. When suddenly something is removed that has been there for so long, do not try and focus on its absence or how beautiful it is that it's now that it's not there, because this will unnerve us. So we just say, wow, did I do something? Wow, did I not do something? Wow. Obviously, we know we did something, but we do not try to go any, we don't try to focus on that. We know it's done. Okay, so now the point is just wowing that fact and holding on to some utility here, which is wow. We're not saying that something's been done. We're not saying that something hasn't been done. But we're in the catbird seat because we do know it has been done, so we can afford this position of saying, I don't know if it's been done. I don't know if it's not being done. We can afford to do that. So I may not pay attention to that for quite some time. And maybe someday when I'm calmed down, I'll just look up and say, oh, it's not there anymore. Great. You know, but you have to gradually let it sink in that it's not there anymore. The trouble is not there anymore. What do you do when you get a glimpse? When you chop wood and carry water. That's the Zen thing. You say, ah, okay, keep. Yeah. Don't focus on the result. Don't focus on the dawn. The dawn is there. Everything will be lit up by it without us focusing on the dawn. We don't have to stare at the sun as it arises. When you recognize the dawn is coming, you prepare yourself to see everything in a new light. You know, the darkness is lifted off the land. That's what we need to prepare for, not the sun rising in the sky, so to speak. Right? That's going to happen. We know it's coming, so we just say, "Wow, everything is so beautiful. Wow, More beautiful than expected. Wow. More beautiful than expected. Wow. More than expected. Wow. More than expected. Wow. For sure, it will be more than we expected. So we have to condition ourselves to this expect more than expected. Without saying way more than expected. Just condition ourselves, say more than expected. More beautiful than expected. More comprehensive than expected. Wow. More comprehensive than expected. Wow. More clear than expected. Wow. More present than expected. Wow. More wow than expected. Wow. More wow than expected. Wow. So as the dawn takes place, before it's just darkness, we don't know what's there. Now the dawn comes up and suddenly all the plants, the flowers, the landscape, everything is revealed. As if it were all at once, revealed all at once. It's all there. So it's more than expected. Our expectations can never encompass it's always vague, right? It's always vague. So it's for sure more than expected. Wow. Peaceful. Peacefulness more than expected. Glory more than expected. Inexpressibleness more than expected. Inexplicable. More than expected. Inexplicable more than expected. Wow. Inexplicable more than expected. Wow. And just condition your expectations that in every which way is going to be more than expected. And just condition your expectations. Reshape, condition your expectations in this way. This is done on faith. Because if every time we try to practice this way, we need to do this long justification to our thinking about why we're doing it, what's going to happen, how come this could work, how, you know, that will stop our practicing right in its tracks because it'll be too laborious. Too laborious for anyone. I used to do this. We all have. And maybe I practice once or twice. I say, okay, wait a minute. Okay, this seems like it might work now, you know. Why is it working? And how can I make it better? Or is there some other thing I need to do? Or what kind of results should I expect? And how did I figure this out? And all this laborious thinking. And it's exhausting. And then you say, wow, I don't want to practice again because, you know, go through that again. That's too laborious. It's too much labor. So at some point, we have to just forego all of that. Pondering and thinking and considering and all this, and just go on sheer faith and just practice. No explanation at all. Just, I have faith. That's all there is to it. This I feel is going to work, and so just doing it is all I have to do. That's it. Just do the practice. That's it. I don't have to apply anything, do anything else other than just practice this. Recondition my expectations. That's all that's required. But just direct reconditioning. Wow. More wow than expected. Wow. More wow than expected. Wow. More wow than expected. Wow. Now, certainly, there are those who have pointed this out. Jesus certainly did that in Dialogue on Awakening. Pointed out very clearly. He says, you will never leave illusion by trying to figure out a way to leave illusion, a way to exit, a way to get free of it, etc. He says you have to pivot your efforts towards expecting the joy. He calls it the joy. I don't really know what joy is, so I don't use that word. Haven't had any joy in my life. But the point is that you have to use some word, so he used that word. But turn, he says, turn away from illusion. Don't worry about it. And what he's really saying is recondition your expectations towards what you are going to be experiencing. And crucial to that is it's going to be more than we expect. That's an addition that I'm adding in here, which for me is absolutely crucial. Now, we don't want to scare ourselves by saying it's way more than expected. No, we just say it's more than expected, more than expected. And so we kind of remain calm. There's a little edge to it. We want an edge to it, but we want a little edge to it. We don't want it to be too sharp of an edge, okay? Like a butter knife, okay? It's a butter knife. So we could say the butter knife practice. It's more than expected, wow. All-inclusive, more than expected, wow. All-inclusive, more than expected, wow. So keep this in mind, the difference between a sharp knife and a butter knife, okay? The sharp knife is scary, right? It's kind of dangerous and scary. Butter knife, it's not dangerous or scary, is it? But it's still a knife, right? It's still a knife. You can cut the butter with it, right? You can spread the butter. Very useful. But it doesn't feel scary. So we don't want to introduce any fear into this, okay? But at the same time, we want to say, yeah, there is an edge to it, a butter knife edge to it. So it's more comprehensive than expected. Wow. 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 More sight than expected. Wow. More sight than expected. Wow. More perception than expected, wow. More healing than expected, wow. More change than expected, wow. More reversal than expected, wow. More healing than expected, wow. More healing than expected, wow. More healing than expected, wow. So just in this little wow practice here, this little expectation practice here. So I'm just giving out sort of the basic stuff, but for you, each one of us, the Holy Spirit will suggest something that resonates with you deeply. So that's the form that you should use. I cannot tell you exactly what form to use, because each one of you may be unique in this. So again, it's the form the Holy Spirit will, you'll feel it. Somehow it arises within you to do it a certain way, and it will resonate with you that this is going to work. This will work. You feel it very strongly. So you just go with that feeling and do it. Wow, more healed perception than expected. Wow. Greater healed perception than expected. Wow. Okay, and butter knife your practice, though. Okay, this is very important that you do not try to add to shock by using a sharp, sharp knife, like an extremely vast, vastly and extremely greater than I expected. That's the sharp knife. You want to avoid that at all costs. Because you're already very fragile. And just feel, if you're like super, super fragile, just consider how reassuring a butter knife is. It's very reassuring. You could spread, the butter on your bread, right? Cut the butter, spread the butter on the bed. Ah, it tastes great. It works great. But if you're really fragile and jittery, you don't want anything to do with a razor sharp knife, do you? Ah, Absolutely not. So this is very, very important to just say greater or more, like more healed perception than expected. Wow. More healed perception than expected. Wow. More healed perception than expected. Wow. More healed perception than expected. Well, don't try to do anything with this practice. This practice is aimed at the root of it all. And the mind struggles to get to the root. Absolutely struggles. It can't really see it. It cannot, our thinking cannot really get there. It can just do a lot of turmoil trying to get there. So sure, the mind can try to get there, but you will ultimately feel very tired and frustrated and feeling like, well, I tried really hard to get there, you know, so that's good enough. No, because that's exhausting and failure. It's only reinforcing failure. So this more healed perception than expected, wow, that does get to the root of it. See, this is not a thinking. This is a direct assertion. It's a direct statement, assertion. It's not trying to figure anything out. We're stating super positively, more healed perception than expected. Wow. It's just a statement of fact. It's not trying, searching. It's not a search. There's no search there. So our practicing is not a searching. It's refuse to search. Refuse to search. Refuse to search. Every time you stop practicing, the mind goes back to searching. So just refuse to search. More healed perception than expected. Wow. More healed perception than expected. Wow. It's like saying more dawn than expected. Wow. Or more light than expected. Wow. As you see the dawn, you say, okay, more light than expected. Wow. More light than expected. Wow, this is an interesting way to look at it. Is the dawn is coming, the sun is arising. You know, we just sit there and say, okay, wow, more light than expected. Wow, if we've been in darkness for so long, as the sun rises, finally, isn't it going to be more light than expected? How could it not be? How can those who have lived in darkness for so long have a comfort familiarity zone with bright sunlight? Is that possible? We expect darkness. So of course it's going to be more light than expected. There's no way around that. See, there's no way around our expectations, actually. You know, it's the price we pay for our folly is our expectations. The price for believing in darkness is our expectations. That's the price. So now we have to pay the price, that's all. So the price is easily paid through this practice. Easily paid off. We easily pay off our mortgage in this way, right? More light than expected. Wow. And it saves face. It saves face. We need to save face. This is very important. What we're doing, the way that we advocate here, saves face. Saves face. Our face. It saves our face, so to speak. You know? We don't say, oh my gosh, that's like infinitely more light than expected. It's so, you know, well, we're losing face. But if we say, well, it's more light than expected, saves face, doesn't it? So this way is not a self-conflicted way. It's not attacking the ego. It's none of that. None of that. We don't believe there's some ego that's separate from us that we need to attack or get free of or anything like that. No. It's our own folly. It's our own misadventure that is in play. That's all it is. It's our own hallucination that's at play. Nothing more than that. So, saving face is extremely important. Say it. This is more light than expected. Wow. And when you practice this way, you will feel a lack of conflict within you, a whole different feeling than other ways that try to kill the ego, to triumph over the ego, this kind of stuff, that kind of nonsense, really. No, we have just imagined an imaginary scenario for ourselves to such an extent that we expect it will continue forever. And now we're realizing we're finally getting free of it. So why should we be so angry at ourselves? Or what is there to be angry at? We have to have compassion for ourselves. Compassion for ourselves. For what we are. The power of our creativity turned to imagination, wishful thinking, was such that it brought about these expectations that this darkness would continue forever. So now, suddenly, the light is dawn. We're in this in-between mode. How do we respond to this? Do we say, oh my God, what an idiot I've been, how could I start recriminating ourselves? That just removes the confidence from us. So we don't want to knock the confidence out of ourselves. Not at all. So we say, we accept what's happening, but we also say, well, it's more than expected. We don't have to completely lose our pride or our confidence. We want to keep our confidence in ourselves. Otherwise, we would panic because we say, well, I don't have any confidence. I don't know how to function then. So we maintain confidence. So yeah, it's more light than expected. Wow. And the wow also is how we save face. Because we want to be able to say something about it. Kind of like, yeah, I expected this, or this is why it happened. We want to have sort of like, sure. So we say, yeah, wow. Wow is my statement of recognition, of confidence in myself. And at the same time, it's not being stupid. It's admitting, yeah, this is certainly more than I expected. Okay. So certainly I need to wow this. But we're not going into panic. Like saying this is overwhelming. No, we do not allow this overwhelmingness. Okay, that is what puts us into trouble. That's when we again imagine there's some self, separate self, that we need to recriminate against and get rid of, and we put the trouble onto them. The conflict again arises. We do not want to be overwhelmed at all. So, yeah, more light than expected. Wow. Factual enough, isn't it? Factual and face-saving at the same time. No panic. More light than expected. Wow. Moreness than expected. Wow. More than expected. Wow. Moreness. Yeah. Moreness than expected. Wow. That's a great way to put it. I'd never tried that one before. Moreness than expected. Wow. Keep it very abstract like this. Abstraction helps us save face. Keeps us out of definition as much as we can. We don't want to save face by defining. You see, That's what happens when we it's more than we expected. We say, I got to save faith. How do I do it? Well, if I can define this, you know, and we go back into that. We don't want to do that. We don't want to be overwhelmed, and we don't want to try to save faith through definition. So, wow, more moreness than expected. Wow, more moreness than expected. Wow. So, from what I saw last night, I saw enough to now know how to practice, you know, to easing this. And I would say more moreness than expected. Wow. Something along those lines I'll come up with. Something, yeah, more moreness than expected. Wow. This is a beautifully abstract, face-saving type of practice. Neither defining nor being overwhelmed, but saving face for us, saving our confidence. That's called compassion. Now, is the golf drama over? Maybe. Or maybe they're in a playoff, right? Who knows? We've been an hour here. So if you play, they had, what, 4 holes left to play? 3.5? 10 minutes a hole, maybe. Even 15 minutes a hole, it's 45 minutes. It's an hour. Yeah, they're probably in a playoff at this point. Possibly. Or not, right? But we spent this time in an extraordinarily helpful way. More moreness than expected. Wow. More moreness than expected. We don't turn the ego into a whipping boy, okay? A scapegoat. There is no egoic self at all. So the more we look for a scapegoat, the more deluded we become. We're the ones who hallucinate the absence of reality, not the ego. The ego is, we just blamed it on something. We blamed it on the ego. We said, well, there's this I. You know, I is to blame. Or someone's to blame. Not us. Not us. But those who do not practice in such a skillful way with compassion, face-saving compassion like that we're practicing here, they inevitably go into scapegoating and blaming, which is what the world is into right now, big time. When you lose a faith-based, grace-based culture, you go into scapegoating, for sure. For sure. Which Jesus pointed out 2,000 years ago, 2,000 plus, is the people had lost their way. They had gone into a sacrificial, scapegoating culture. They had gotten away from faith in the grace of God. And so they said, hey, let's blame Jesus. We need someone to scapegoat. We have to have the path of scapegoating must be successful, is what they believe. Okay, must be successful. This is the way we have to do it. We have to find someone to blame. That never works. That never works. because it avoids responsibility for the entire situation. We're responsible for hallucinating the absence of reality and trying to be greater than God and be the prime creator of a new reality. We're the ones that hallucinated. God didn't hallucinate. There was no ego. The ego didn't hallucinate. There's no ego to hallucinate. We hallucinate the absence of reality, then claim that there's something else that did it. And so we think, well, we have to kill what did the hallucination, and then we'll be fine. But that still, there's this gap of honesty there, isn't there? We're still fearful of more than expected. That hasn't reshaped our expectations at all. That's not the path of grace and compassion and skillful means. The world's in a very sacrificial mood right now, having abandoned the grace of God. There's nowhere else for it to go, except into that dead end, that dead end of sacrificial belief system, sacrificial belief. That's what happens. You go into that dead end. So, but we are not going into that dead end. So we're going to focus on what we're doing. And that's more wow. More wow than expected. Wow. We can say that. More wow than expected. Wow. More than expected. Wow. Yeah. We think we can save face by telling God, look, God, we didn't hallucinate the ego, your absence. The ego did, but we've killed the ego, so everything's fine now. Have we really then God would tell us, well, where did the ego come from? I didn't create the ego. I didn't give any power. You know, you're saying that there was some other entity that I didn't create, that is not of creation, that had the power to hallucinate the absence of creation, and that this power seduced you in, and you've been trapped by this power. He says, what is that? I know nothing of the ego at all. And so then we're still at odds with reality, aren't we? All because we don't know how to save face, compassionately save face, the skill to save face, as we see the dawn and see more light than I expected. Instead, we turn away from the light and go on a crusade against the ego. You see, go on crusades. Instead of being able to, how do we skillfully handle this more than expected? Wow. Because we realize, oh my gosh, I just hallucinated the absence of this. So I really have been hallucinating the total absence of all of this. And we'll feel like persecuted by this if we don't know how to handle it properly, if we don't know how to wow it properly. And we'll feel it's threatening to us. Then we'll blame the ego, blame someone. They're you know, trying to force us into something we don't want. So the skill of a grace-based, faith-based culture, the skill in practicing, faith in God to practice, is essential to avoid a scapegoating culture where there's always somebody else is trying to push you into some situation that is ruined, that you feel is ruinous for you, and therefore you have the right to try and, you know, sacrifice them. People felt that Jesus was trying to, they took it that he was trying to force them, push them into being overwhelmed, which they feel is like panic and annihilation. So in order to avoid that, you know, they blame Jesus. Said, you're the reason why we don't feel good, meaning why we feel panicky. Now, the reason they feel panicky is their desire for true happiness, but the expectations that they have are too small of a cup. You know, they have this small little cup, and you know, there's this ocean of water being poured into this little cup, and they say, you know, it's too much. I'm being attacked by it. You know, that they view it, I'm being attacked. So we have to have what we could call a dharmic culture, a grace-based, faith-based culture that understands this dynamic, that we have a very severe problem. And if we don't approach it right, we're going to go sour. Okay, the whole thing will sour, as it has. This world is very much in a sour mood. The prodigal son, we had the situation here in the Bay Area of a favorite son of the Bay Area, Pablo Sandoval, favorite son of the Bay Area for 7 years. Everybody loved the panda, the Kung Fu panda. He was just the life of the party, won 3 world championships here, the best times we've ever had here in the Bay Area. It was absolutely fabulous. But he became a free agent, and he signed with the Boston Red Sox because he wanted to conquer new worlds, I believe. You know, he said, you know, I want to see what I can do elsewhere. But in his heart, he didn't really want to leave. It was kind of like the son wanting to leave the house, his home, and you know, go out and make a name for himself elsewhere. And so that's what he did. And on the way out, of course, sour grapes. He didn't really want to leave, but since he was leaving, he had to try and rationalize it. So he said a lot of bitter things about the Giants, and he didn't, you know, the players. I'm not friends with any of them really, except for Hunter Pence. And I was disrespected by the organization. He had to justify his leaving. Obviously, sour grapes. You know, you don't get the grapes you really want, so you say, "Oh, those grapes are sour anyway." It's you know, classic. If you understand psychology, you would have understood what he was doing. So I just sort of laughed and said, "Okay, well, you know, he's sour graping the whole thing." But you know, a lot of the fans in the Bay Area got so angry and upset at him. How dare he, not understanding this is a young man who wants to conquer new worlds. You know, he conquered the Bay Area, and now he says, wow, let me see if I can conquer Boston and the American League and be the superhero, you know, even greater. But deep down, he said, you know, this is probably the wrong move. It's not going to work out well, and it certainly didn't. So he sour graped what he was leaving. Okay, so it worked out terrible for him in Boston. Absolutely terrible. Hold on. I was blasting this rap music and Google's going to flag it. Google's going to flag that. They hear that. So if you told me a week ago that Pablo Sandoval was going to be returned to the Giants, I would have said that's ridiculous, utterly absurd, not possible. Because the bad blood was, you know, had been there for 3 years and really bad blood, and he's terrible. He was playing terrible. He was complete bust for Boston. They signed him for like $95 million. He did nothing for them. He was sick. He was injured. He was out of shape. He was fat. He was goofing around. It was just a complete disaster. And it was so bad that Boston finally said, you know what, Pablo, we just don't want you around. We're going to release you. Even though we owe you $49.5 million still. We're on the hook for that. Guaranteed contracts. We don't want you around. Goodbye. And they released him, still owing him basically $50 million. They ate it all. That's how bad they wanted to get rid of him. Second worst bust in free agent history, second to Josh Hamilton. So this is extraordinary. And then the rumor started saying the Giants were interested in signing him. And everyone's saying, what? This guy's been like the worst player in baseball over the last 3 years. Complete bust. He badmouthed the, you know, us leaving. He badmouthed us so severely. That's ridiculous. You know, that's completely ridiculous. Everyone's just laughed like that can't happen. It's just utterly absurd. But then we say, well, might. Then we heard it might happen. And then we heard it's going to happen. And then suddenly it happened. And it's like, what? Well, I said right away, I said, you know, it's the prodigal son. It's the prodigal son returning back to his home. Just like we need to return back to the home of reality, to the more-moreness. More-moreness than expected, wow. More-moreness than expected, wowness of reality. Out of this imagined hallucination of the absence of reality, this imagined darkness, which is a hallucination of the absence of reality, he returned to where he had his idyllic, fabulous days. World Series MVP in 2012. A very, very delightful, fun-loving, you know, laugh-a-minute kind of person. It just the vibe was just wonderful that we had here for those 7 years. And he was a big part of it. The others played a big part of it too, but he was an important cog, you know, in the machine of the dynasty of the Giants. And he's returning home after just being flogged, you know, he ventured to some far country. He just had a terrible time there. And he says, please, I just want to go home. And the Giants said, come on home, Pablo. We want you back. And it's amazing. And so he apologized to the fans. He apologized to his teammates, to the organization. He was contrite. He's now in San Jose, single A, minor leagues. Played there last night. And he looks great. I saw him. And I said, what? I've never seen him look so good. He's you know, slimmed way down. He looks very athletic. I say, my gosh, that's amazing. Maybe he can still play. I don't know. But the issue is the prodigal son being welcomed back home. And so I said to people, hey, Pablo's coming back. Everyone I see, hey, Pablo. And you know what? Everybody's reaction to me, I did it to so many different people just to see what the reaction was. Scornful, bitter, hostile, scornful, scapegoatish, sacrificial. No grace. No one said, you know what? Even if he doesn't do good, the prodigal son's coming back. That's great. There are a few people online that said that. There's a few that get it. They still say, you know, they see it. It's the prodigal son. It's a story of we're welcoming him back because he admitted he made a mistake. He said, I never should have left. I never should have left here. I made a big, big mistake leaving here. And he did. He did. Now, thankfully, he did because he played lousy. But it's never been the same since he left. And he admitted his mistake. You see, this is the prodigal son. So we need to say, God, you know, I never should have hallucinated your absence. And pretend that I left. You know, all I could do was pretend that I left. God, I couldn't really leave. So now I'm faced with this expectation problem, right? Because it's more-moreness than expected, right? And there's nothing you can do about that, God, because you can't be any less than what you are. So I cannot ask you to be less. I cannot say, God, give me some sacrificial victim to make you less than what you are. Okay, I cannot do that. I have to acclimatize myself to you. Now, we can do this in ways that makes it seem less as we're acclimatizing, like more-moreness than expected. Wow, that's fine. But God is not making itself less. No. So we can have this sort of bridge as we cross it it's, you know, we're acclimatizing ourselves to more moreness than expected. Wow. To the allness, actually. Wow. But we're not saying the allness. We're just saying more moreness than expected. Wow. We're not admitting to the allness. You see, that's overwhelming for us. That'll drive us back into sacrificial stuff. And you got to wonder if Jesus' situation of actually being here in the world wasn't overwhelming to people. I believe it certainly was. Now, he must have had a reason for this in some way. Maybe it was just his karma, you know, to go through that, to try and force the issue in some way. I don't know. But it was certainly overwhelming to the people. And when that happens, they go back into a sacrificial mode, saying, God, we need to sacrifice part of you because you're too much. You're too much for us. But we don't have to do that here. We can just say, wow, more moreness than expected. Wow. And stay in this practice mode. We save face. We don't have to go and become sacrificial. The prodigal son's coming back. And we're going to the minor leagues. What did Pablo do? He went to the minor leagues without any complaints, with a happy love to be here. It's great. He went just single A, high single A, San Jose. Not triple A, single A. And then after 3 days there, I think he's going to go and join the triple A team. So he's contrite. You know, he swallowed his pride. He swallowed his pride. The panda swallows his pride. Good for him. Good for him. Takes a lot of, it takes a lot of grace to do that. It takes a lot of grace, inner fortitude to do that. You know, to eat humble pie like this, swallow your pride, and, you know, World Series MVP now is down in single A ball, being released, being owed $50 million. That's how bad they wanted to get rid of him. You know, will always be a shame on his career, that kind of thing. They'll never let him forget it in Boston, that's for sure. And he's saying, okay, I just want to recover my career. I want to recover. I believe I can do it, and I want to do it. And whatever it takes to do it is fine. I'm going on a single A ball with the kids down there. Two-time All-Star, three-time World Series champion, World Series MVP. You know, this is a very storied baseball player, actually. And he's down it with the kids in single-A ball. Prodigal son. So this is a really super, super great example for us, right at the time we need it here. And I picked up on this big time. But most people are just saying, "Yeah, you know, hate that guy. He's worthless, garbage." They're very hostile. The people are in a very snappy mood right now. This is what I discern. Very snappy mood. But what a great object lesson for us. Swallow your pride. Admit your mistakes. You made a fundamental mistake. We should have never tried to leave reality, right? Leave home. We just hallucinated that we left home. But this leaves us with an expectation problem, doesn't it? Because at some point we have to realize we never left. And we didn't do anything to it. There's no in-between, actually, between where we've been and where we've always been in reality. So it's not like we're journeying from some distant land back to reality. But the quote-unquote distant land is only our expectations of how much is really, how much did we imagine was gone. And as we start to open up, we say, oh my gosh, I really have been hallucinating the total absence of reality. I've been hallucinating that it's not there at all. Blackout. I blacked out. I blacked it out. And so there's more than expected, right? More than expected. But with Pablo, is it, well, it's still baseball. I love baseball. So I'm still playing baseball. I'm in the Giants organization now. And if I do well, they're going to promote me because they need me up there, third base. So it's just win, 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 win. You know, what have I got to feel sorry about for myself? Not at all. I'm in a great position. So even though we're in a lowly position here, we're just saying, wow, more than expected, wow. And we're not pontificating all this non-dual teaching or Dzogchen teaching or any of this stuff. No, we're just down in the minor leagues here. It's just more wow than wow. More than expected, wow. More wow than expected, wow. So we're just humbly eating humble pie here. Okay? That's the minor leagues. That's fine. That's fine. We'll pay our dues in the minor leagues. Thank you very much. Because we're not going to risk going back into that sacrificial system, belief system, which is rampant in the world right now. This is the supreme danger of the times here, is so many in the world are now just in lockstep with sacrificial belief system and are in a vicious mode, vicious bitey mode. And so we're avoiding that by laying low, being very lowly. Just minor leagues. I'm just a minor league single A ball player. That's all I am. But yeah, I do have a contract with the big league club. He did have a contract, but his contract stipulates he has to assign to the minor leagues to get in shape. So we do have a contract with the big league club, with God here. We do have a contract here. No doubt about it. The glimpses, the recognitions I have had make it very clear. I've got a contract with God here, no doubt about it. But we need to get in shape, meaning we need to reshape our expectations. We're not ready for the big leagues yet. The sacrificial people think they're on the fast path, the fast track. They say, "No, I just sacrifice the right, make the right sacrifice, and then I don't have any problem with my expectations." Reality is now fragmented, and I'm used to fragmentation, so no problem like that. So that's a dead end. I believe maybe Jesus' sacrifice or something was a way to shame the people of that time. You know, he said that he had to do it in a certain way that people could relate to. They were so proud. So proud of their sacrificial belief system that it would work, that they were willing to sacrifice Jesus. We said, this will work. But when they did sacrifice him, they were mortified at what they'd done. They were ashamed of what they'd done. They said, my God, what have we done? So I believe that there was some sort of shock treatment that Jesus did. He addresses that in Dialogue on Awakening, that he said was my own choice. For I wanted to do something for the people of that time, for the way that they viewed everything, and so that they could, this would resonate with them in some way. That's why he said, that's why I did it. And it really stunned their mindset, to point out that they were willing to sacrifice Jesus, this extraordinarily loving presence, and that they just felt, this is the Son of God. This is so wonderful, and that there he was, you know, nailed to a cross in front of them. You know, and they did it, and so it really, really, really shocked and stunned them. I mean, after the crucifixion, the apostles, etc., give account, you know, of just, oh my gosh, you know, what has happened? What did we do? This is crazy. Something's wrong with us, you know. But they got this feeling, you know, something is wrong. It sort of made the whole sacrificial belief system for them very bitter, so bitter, they just said, we have to find another way. You know, this is just terrible. This is what it led to. And we're still not saved. You know, they're still, they some of them later tried to say, no, you know, that they invented some convoluted belief system that the sacrifice of Jesus saved them. They're still believing in that. But the ones who really took it to heart said, wow, that was really shameful, what we did. And it's so shameful that we don't want to be a part of this actually anymore. And so then they turned what? To the Holy Spirit. So Jesus shocked them and shamed them and then told them, I'm leaving, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to pay attention to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will now lead you out of, you know, this terrible sacrificial belief system that you've been in, that you feel now that you're just rotten to the core. So rotten to the core. People felt just rotten about themselves. But their belief system said, my God, this sacrificial belief system, look where it led us. Look what it led us to do. You know, we were into sacrificing pigeons and goats and sheep and stuff. But then we ended up sacrificing Jesus, who was the absolute picture of normality. The normality of God. So really, it reflected our desire to sacrifice God in order to be reconciled with God. And how crazy is that, you know, that we need to sacrifice God in order to be reconciled with God? And they realized that's totally rotten, isn't it? Their honesty, it hit them. It's like, that's dishonest. It's so rottenly dishonest, isn't it? That can't possibly be the answer. And so some listened to the Holy Spirit, and they began to make progress. Others just swept it under the rug and said, well, no, the sacrifice was successful. So we sacrificed God in order to be reconciled with God. And that's a sacrificial belief system. And they're still, you know, trapped in that dead end to this day. So it's something along those lines that Jesus did for a certain group of people. And he said the sacrifice is not a lesson for everyone necessarily. It can be. It's very helpful because it shows us what the sacrificial belief system is all about. That we think we need to sacrifice God, get rid of God in order to be reconciled with God. Well, what God are we then being reconciled to? A God of death. A God of fragmentation. A God of non-reality. A God that we can kill. Why do we want to be reconciled with that God? Well, because we're overwhelmed by the true God. We're overwhelmed by the moreness than expected. Wow. We don't have the skillful means of a bridge to ease us into this, because we've forsaken the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, and a faith-based culture that would enable us to practice in the right way. The genius of the Holy Spirit is not through explanation, but through right practice. Sure, it can give some explanation, but it's the real genius is in the right practice. How do we save face, okay, and not be overwhelmed? Not be overwhelmed and save face at the same time. The wow practice does just exactly that. I got a big thank you from God a couple days ago. A big thank you. How does God feel towards me? God expressed it and just was just, thank you. What more needs to be said? That says it all right there. But that doesn't relieve me of the necessity of practicing, does it? Because I've been in the darkness, just like everyone else. And I see the light now, and it's moreness than expected. Wow. So I have to keep practicing. I'm still down here in single A ball. Now, some of these kids may think I'm a big shot. No. I do have a contract. I have, you know, I may be called up to the big leagues soon. Maybe. But they might be also, right? Maybe they're ready for the big leagues too. So I'm still practicing here, even though I'm able to express this here on video for the world, I'm still practicing, humbly practicing, because it's more moreness than expected. Wow, that is for sure. And it certainly will be for the foreseeable future, right? That's the very essence of God, is more moreness. From our standpoint, is more moreness than expected. Wow, we need to add that in there. And so we have this little island of wow that we say, I still got this really, this wow that's not too much more moreness, right? It's wow. I'm not saying it's more moreness. I'm not saying it's not more moreness. Okay, so, but I'm saving face by this wow. Saving face, more moreness than expected, wow. Wow enables the momentum to still be there. It also saves face for us. So it's win-win. The wow is really win-win. But again, the lack of a faith-based culture now is, for most people, it's overwhelming, you might say. And they're going to look for scapegoats, for sure. That's why I've been told to lay low. Very, very emphatically, lay low. Do not put yourself in a position at this point of that Jesus put himself into back in the holy, the days when he was in the Holy Land. Do not say, I'm the Son of God, I'm the Savior of the world. No, because people will say, oh great, you're the one we need to sacrifice then. Just put yourself, you're this lowly, single A baseball player trying to make it back to the club. You got quite a ways to go. You got a lot to prove before that happens. So before we're some world savior, we have a lot to prove, right? We have a lot of adjustments to make in our expectations. And in that way, you don't really seem like a sacrificial candidate to the world. And let's not underestimate the sacrificial intensity of these times. It's ferocious, very ferocious. This is what happens when we abandon faith-based culture. This is what inevitably happens. We go to materialism, and we try to force a change in the mind somehow. We try to force ourselves to fixate. We think a sacrifice will fixate God, and then that'll reconcile us to God. We say, God, if we can just fixate you, then we can reconcile with you. So they say we have to kill God in order to be reconciled with God. In other words, change what God is so we can be then reconciled. To what? To a changed God. To a God that no longer is God. And therefore we say, oh, that meets our expectations. No problem. See, so we're trying to meet our expectations instead of getting used to our expectations being exceeded. Instead of reshaping our expectations, the world, the sacrificial belief system, is trying to get its expectations met rather than practicing reshaping their expectations. That's the difference, right, between a dharmic culture and a materialistic culture. Or a non-dharmic culture. Non-dharmic culture is always saying, no, we can meet our expectations. These are the expectations we have, and we're going to get reality to conform to those expectations. That's materialism. Dharmic culture says, no, reality cannot be changed. We have to reshape our expectations to help us conform with reality. And that requires a very careful, face-saving practice that has momentum, saves face, blocks panic. They don't get overwhelmed, blocks the panic. You have to go about it very cautiously, carefully, and patiently with diligence and steady determination. That's what's required. And faith in the practices, faith in the Holy Spirit. That's what's required. Faith in the Holy Spirit. Now, if we had a faith-based culture, what I'm saying, people would say, of course, yeah. And they do it. But because we don't, it seems to be not catching on and not spreading like in a faith-based culture. It would be like just acceptance. Yeah, this is great. You know, look, and this is what we need to hear. Then, and this is what we will pay attention, etc. But not in this particular climate these days. That those kind of flowers aren't growing in the climate that we have right now. So when you talk about climate change, it's really this: we're going to a sacrificial belief system in this world, severely non-dharmic culture. That's what's the real climate change in the world. That's the real problem. And Jesus points this out in Dialogue on Awakening. He was asked about climate change and environmental change, etc. And he says, look, he spoke the truth, which is more than we expected to hear. So you have to read it carefully. Anyone who's speaking the truth is more than we expect to hear. It's better than we expect. Wow. And so you have to do it in little bits, little bit, little bit, little bit. Take it in. Get used to it, reshape your expectations, and then next time it's a little easier. It's like that. You have to really, really give yourself patience and allow yourself to let it sink in and block the panic. But he said it's your mental climate that's the problem. He said the world is just a reflection, a total projection, reflection of what's going on with your mind. And that's all it is. It's just a mirror. So there's no world out there to blame, saying that there's climate change happening out there. The climate change is happening within our mind. And he says if you change your mind, the world will conform to that. And he says that's true in every regard, in terms of plagues, in terms of environmental troubles, climate warming, everything. Everything about the world, he says, it's really just what's actually happening, taking place in your mind. And he didn't soft sell it, you know. He very directly, very clearly said this is what is true. And the other is simply not true. The idea that there's something happening out there, there's never anything happening out there, he says. And of course, climate change and whatever environmental damage we've done is just an attempt, again, to sacrifice God so that we can be reconciled with God. That's all that it is. Which, if you look at it, is an obvious absurdity. We imagine this world to be God's creation, and so we're sacrificing it in order to be reconciled. But we don't want to sacrifice too much of it, because then we'll think that there won't be anything to be reconciled with. So we're in this very edgy situation here, actually. And you might be asking, well, yeah, it seems impossible, but not to the Holy Spirit, it isn't. So the Holy Spirit knows how you can practice to get past this seeming impasse. There are ways to practice. The Holy Spirit will tell you how to practice, and ultimately it's reshaping our expectations. is all practice is aimed to reshaping our expectations. Now, there's many ways to reshape our expectations, and in fact, each one of us will have a slightly unique way of doing it. But that's still exactly what we're doing, is reshaping our expectations. Saying reality can't be changed, but our expectations can. Okay? So we can change our expectations, reshape our expectations such that they get much, much closer to accepting reality as it is. And again, wow, more moreness than expected. Wow, more moreness than expected. Wow. This is a wonderful way of expressing where we're at here. More moreness than expected. Wow. Don't try to envision the moreness. Just stay in single A ball. You know, you're not a big shot yet. Don't try to be a big shot. The club will call you up when they're ready for you. You just have to show them that you're ready. So don't try to imagine, oh, I'm in the big leagues and all the fans and the great ballparks and the travel and everything. Don't pay any attention to any of that. Just say, more moreness than expected. Wow. The Holy Spirit knows you're practicing properly. And when you're ready, the Holy Spirit will say, okay, you're being promoted, like that. So what the Holy Spirit's looking for, are you going about your business in the right way? Do you know how to practice properly? Are you doing it? That's all that the Holy Spirit's looking at. Looking at Sandoval down there in single A, what are you looking at? How's he running? How's he moving? How's he swinging the bat? You know, what are his reflexes, his baseball instincts? What's his attitude? They're not looking for him to hit home runs every at bat or anything like that. That's unrealistic. They're saying, you know, psychologically, is he ready to go back to the big league? Psychologically, is he ready for it? Will he flop? Will he make a fool out of himself? Or can he handle himself up here? That's what they're looking for. So that's what I was looking for. I didn't care, you know, how he did. If he made outs or whatever, he got a hit the first time up, then got out three times, but he hit the ball hard each time. Hit it hard. Okay? And then they walked one time, so it means, okay, his batting eye is still good. He's making solid contact. Yeah, he hit it hard at somebody. That's fine. He's making good contact. And what's his confidence? How's his confidence? Yeah, this is a question. How's his confidence? You can't get up to the big leagues and lose your confidence. You're done. If that happens, you're done. And this has happened to so many, many players. They get called up before they're ready. They can't handle the overall situation. They lose their confidence. And then they're just a basket case. And they're gone. They're sent back down. You might have players in AAA who are just hitting amazingly well, but they're not ready for the big league psychologically. They're heroes in a little big fish in a small pond. You bring them up to a big ocean up there, and they disappear. They disappear. The stage is too big for them. So, the Holy Spirit knows when you're ready for a bigger stage. And in the meantime, we just practice our trade. More than expected. Wow. And maybe somebody will get called up from the team, single A team. Who knows who it'll be? Someone gets called up to the big league team. They say, the Holy Spirit says, you're ready. What's our reaction to that? Jealousy, envy? Or like, wow, that's great. We're so happy for you. And this shows that there is that the right work does pay off. So let's keep our nose to the grindstone here and keep working at it. Some people it takes longer than others, right? So there's all different reactions when someone gets called to a big league team. You know, some wish them well and say, okay, you know, but I have to get back to my work here and let me focus on my practice, and they don't think about it any more than that. It's just good. And others, you know, get envious and bitter and jealous and think, how come it wasn't me called up? Maybe I'll be the next. And they lose their focus that way. They lose their focus. So again, we're not competing with one another to be called up to the big team. We are simply keeping our focus on the business at hand here, which is right practice. More than expected. Wow. So, you know, who's actually doing the practice? That's what the Holy Spirit's looking at. Not just who's hearing this, but who's actually doing it. Especially on the fly during the day when you're doing all this other stuff. Can you pivot your attention off of all your mental struggles and whatever your mind's thinking of and just go right back to the practice of just straight assertion. Just straight assertion. Wow. More than expected. Wow. The frame of reference shift. Feels more than expected. Wow. Can you listen to what the Holy Spirit tells you to practice? Can you do it? Can you just not worry about what someone else is doing? Just do the best you can. Like golf, you got to hit your own ball. I mean, you may try to psych out the other player and make them play worse, so your result's better. But your result might still be lousy. It's just you pulled someone else down. The Holy Spirit's not looking for that. The Holy Spirit says, look, just because you might have had a better result than someone else, what if their result's lousy? Yours is a little bit better than lousy. Still lousy. That's not going to work. So you have to. Be happy that others are playing well to show the example. That's great. This is a great example. And then just focus on your own game and play well and keep doing it. It's a marathon. It's a marathon. Reshaping our expectations is a marathon. For me, it's been a 50-year marathon, actually. And there's so much that never occurs to us. But if we keep working, suddenly something will occur to us. Say, oh my gosh, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I could say more than expected well. I didn't even know I could expect such a thing from myself, such a focus from myself. It's like, wow. More than expected well. I didn't know I could put it that way and help myself that way. I didn't know I could be that compassionate. See, so we keep seeing more ways to be truly compassionate to ourselves as we go along. More compassionate, like that. Saving face, momentum, and yet saving face, blocking panic. Momentum, save face, block panic. Momentum, save face, block panic. Like that. So I may have had a big shot insight last night. But what am I doing today? I'm down in single A, you know, saying, okay, practicing, wow, more than expected, wow. I'm not writing a book explaining the insight. I could write many books. I could write many books off of that insight. And everyone would think I'm, you know, so smart, incredible. But no, just practicing, wow, more than expected, wow. This is called laying low. More than expected. Wow. Speaking of more than expected, we've gotten more heat than expected here this summer. They keep, I don't know, maybe the weather people are like ultimate wishful thinkers, I believe. They want to give you a happy forecast. So I think this is a sign of the times we live in, such a delusional times. Nobody's willing to be honest. The forecasters consistently have said it's going to be cooler than it is, usually by about 10 degrees. Yesterday they missed it by about 8 degrees, I believe. They said it would be 90, it was 98. But quite often they've missed it by 10 or 11 degrees. And you look at 89 and say, oh, that's not bad, nice summer day. Well, it's actually 98, a scorching 98, not such a nice day. You see, so they're trying to play. It's amazing how the world is playing to this dishonest sort of way of, we just want to please you, you know, we just want to be pleasing, so we'll tell lies. You know, it's going to be 89. But if we know it's going to be 98, we can say, okay, wow, more hotter than we expected, and we can reshape our expectations in that direction. So we have to, if you're playing the role of the forecaster, it's like the role of, if God, you get a glimpse of reality and you realize, wow, that's more than I expected, then you can go to work reshaping it. Whereas if your glimpse of reality is such like, oh no, it's not so much, you know, then why should we go to work reshaping our expectations? We don't. We get lazy. Lazy. That's why the Dharma kings are so important. Like Rama Maharshi, you say, wow, that's more than I expected. Wow, more than expected. Wow. So, do I tear him down, or do I, in my mind, or do I let him remain as he is, and then and the work on my expectations? That's the problem. Don't sacrifice Rama Maharshi. Let him be just as he is, and then my expectations need to be reshaped, not his. So, this whole dishonest, sacrificial belief system is affecting the weather forecast very badly. At least here in the Bay Area, I don't know. It's not just the Bay Area, because it's weather.com, it's Weather Underground, it's these all these computer generated stuff. I mean, what are they talking about? Everyone notices it here. They all know it's just junk. It's super off. You can't be off that badly unless it's intentional. You cannot. Psychologically, they're tending to give us forecasts that we want to hear. Same thing during the drought. Oh, so many forecasts of rain, they were wrong. And we said, what is going on? Are these people totally incompetent? Don't they know there's this high pressure, this ridge blocking? Of course they knew. But they say, no, folks, the rain is coming, believe us. Never came. And this went on for 5 or 6 years of just, you know, they forecast, you know, to make you feel happy, or make you, you know, your expectations say, oh, okay, I don't need to do anything like that. Amazing. Now, I want to know, is it going to be hot? Great. I'll prepare for it then. Just let me know what I need to prepare for. But the world is not doing that. The world is not letting us know what we need to prepare for in terms of really what is, what our mind really is. It's not telling us that at all. But here, we've gotten so many glimpses, right? So here we're preparing for the way reality is. Not the way we expect it to be, but the way it actually is. So we have to reshape our expectations. And we cannot just throw all expectations out the window. That's overwhelming for us. Overwhelming. Theoretically we can, but it's overwhelming. Practically, it's not the right play. We have to reshape first, cross the bridge. You know, we can leap across, okay, if we want. I know Buddha said the wise are already on the other side. Yes. But from that standpoint, then the mind will say, but how did I get across? So we say, you know, already on the, we say, wow, more quickly than expected. Wow. We don't say, I've always been on the other side. Because that becomes just a tautology, a mental position, you see. That's no good. That's not true realization. It's a mental position saying, I'm already on the other side. We say, wow, more quickly, on the other side, more quickly than expected. Wow, on the other side, more quickly than expected. We're not saying we journeyed to the other side, and we're not saying we didn't journey to the other side. See? We're not taking either of those positions. So we still have momentum of admitting we're on the other side. We're saying it more quickly than expected. We're not saying, you know, but we're saving face. We're saving face, saying, well, we could have traveled over here. It's possible. Or we could have already been here. That's possible. We're not saying which it is. It's certainly more quickly than expected. And this eases us into ultimate realization. So talking too much about ultimate realization is most certainly a trap. It seems so easy. Anyone can talk. It's practicing that's difficult. Because then you really feel it. You feel the rawness of it as you're practicing. So anybody, talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. Anybody can talk a good spiritual game if they really want to. It's practicing that you get into the real heart of it. Oh, speaking of that, I had a dream last night. I just remembered it. I sat down on this piano bench next to this piano player. And this piano player was the most incredible piano player I've ever seen or heard. And we had a little talk. And then I don't remember exactly what he said. But he kind of chided me a little bit. Like, really? Are you sure about that? His piano playing was more better than expected. It was more better than expected, especially on the lower registers. He was down there, and it was just dazzling speed, etc., etc., etc. Now I don't know exactly what this represented. Was it materialism? Possibly. And the speed of computers? Possibly. Because the speed that he's playing at, human couldn't do that, actually. Maybe it was a robot playing like that fast. So maybe, and he was saying, aren't you impressed? Or you think, I said, well, you're good. Are you sure? Just good? He said, well, yeah. More, you're more faster than expected. Wow. Okay. So it's an interesting dream. Might have represented materialism and all the sacrifice that it believes in. Sacrificial belief system. He was playing on the left side of the piano. Interesting. Lower registers. Perhaps that means sacrificial belief system and materialism and all of that. I was sitting on the right side. I wasn't playing the piano at all. Because I'm saying, wow, more beautiful than expected. Wow. Just the tone. Tone, more than expected. Wow. That's tone. More tone than expected. Wow. More tone. More beauty than expected. Wow. It's beauty. That's a wonderful way of practicing. More beauty than expected. Wow. More tone than expected. Wow. This conveys it in a better way. More tone than expected. Wow. This helps reshape our expectations, I believe, in a powerful way. If we can get used to expecting that, beauty, not beauty, but beauty, not tone, but tone. peace, more peace than expected, more more beauty than expected. Wow, I like that. More beauty than expected. Wow. More beauty than expected. Wow. And the resistance to this is the sacrificial belief system saying, come back to this, you know, come on back, you're used to it. And so you must not go back to that while you're practicing. You'll go back to it by default. As once you stop practicing, you'll start drifting back into that, for sure. So you just say, well, not now, I'll get back to, you know, maybe a little later. And then, you know, your psyche, you'll accept that. You'll say, okay, yeah, that's okay. But as you get nervous as you're practicing this way, that sacrificial belief system is jumping up and say, you know, hey, let me give you a hand. Let me give you a hand. You know, extend a hand to you. Come on back. I can help you. And say, no. Maybe a little later. Not now, but a little later. More beauty than expected. Wow. More than expected. Wow. More beauty than expected, wow. More grace than expected, wow. More serenity than expected, wow. More serenity than expected, wow. More serenity than expected, wow. More clarity than expected, wow. More clear than expected, wow. More present than expected, wow. More presence than expected, wow. More presence than expected, wow. More normal. Than expected, wow. More perfect. More perfection than expected, wow. More perfection than expected, wow. So reshaping expectations is difficult. It's stressful. It's a stressful on our nerves. We say, "Wow, you know, I'm used to, you know, I'm used to what I'm used to, and now I'm shifting into, you know, reshaping. I'm not so used to it. More perfection than expected. Wow, frame of reference shift. Wow, more perfection than expected. Wow." Frame of reference shift. Wow. I feel more perfection than I expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. Wow. I feel more perfection than I expected. Wow. It's like I'm on a roller coaster here. I have to hold on to the seat, the sides of the seat. You know, it's like, wow, it's more amazing than I expected. Wow, this practice is more better than I expected. Wow, more effective than expected. Wow. This is more fast than I expected. Wow. More fast than I expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. Wow. I feel more fast. I feel this is more fast than I expected. Wow. I feel more fast than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. Wow. Feels more fast than expected. Wow. The frame of reference shift feels more fast than expected. Wow. So it's Sunday here, so I can afford to have this kind of shock treatment, spiritual shock treatment. Is the golf over by now? Absolutely, it's over by now. I don't know who won. There's some Chinese player that shot 7 under par on the final day and rocketed up the leaderboard out of nowhere. Never heard his name. He's 21 year old. He's hardly played at all. He did play in the U.S. Open, I guess, and some other championship thing. But other than that, he hasn't played on the world stage that we know of. You shoot 7 under par, and it's like what's he at? 6 under? He's at 6 under par, I believe. Something like, yeah, he finished. Who knows? The leaders may cough it up. They may have coughed it up. They were, I think, tied at 8 under par going to the 15th hole. But double bogeys are out there. You know, they could both bogey a couple holes and they could fall back to 6 under par, you know, or even 5, and he could win. He came out of nowhere, played early in the day, posted an amazing score. Spieth was struggling. The nerves were getting to him. The pressure was getting to him, for sure. Spray your shot 100 yards, right? Took him 5 minutes to find the ball. I mean, but yeah, you expect that. So you expect that at some point the pressure is just going to like pop, you know, he's going to pop for a while. And he did. When he started the round with 3 bogeys and 4 holes, you know, the pressure was obviously getting to him. And then it popped later on, but you don't know. He may have said, okay, you know, wow. He may have gone into wow mode and back into blackout mode, he calls it, of blocking everything else out. All swing thoughts out. Blocking. He calls it blackout mode, meaning like his putting. Blacks out all considerations of stance. How do I feel? You know, what's my putting stroke like? Is this, how am I going to do this? It's all blacked out. He's able to black it out. And all he's focused on is seeing the blur of the ball, the line, the blur of the line as the ball goes towards the hole. That's all he's focused on. And he says when he does that, you know, that's when he's putting great. He calls it blackout mode. You black out all the thinking and the hoping and the fearing. And you just focus on the wowing of, wow, that's a like blurring line going towards the hole. I like that. Just wow. You're not thinking, you know, am I going to make it? Am I going to miss it? No, I'm just looking at as I hit the ball, there's this sort of white blur, he says. I just see this white blur as the ball's rolling, tracing this line. And that's all I'm seeing. That's all I'm seeing. So he's able to simplify it to that extent. And that's, you know, great mental capacity there. That's the Zen of golf right there. The great golfers have that. Rory McIlroy, he found his game again, and he said, it's just two, I have two little mental tricks I use before I hit a shot. I just tell myself this and this, and that's it. And he said that blocks everything else out. It just calms me all down. And he said, it's a little mental trick I use. He said, I'd forgotten it, and I rediscovered it. And what did he do? He's in at 5 under. He played great. He started out terrible. He's like 5 over par to start the tournament. Since then, he's been the best player out there. And he said, because I just tell myself these two little mental cues, and it blocks everything else out. That the good players, that's what they're doing, folks. Okay, they have these little mental practices that they're really good at. And they're able then to just block all the thinking out. They're calm, they're focused, they're relaxed, they're not aiming for expectations or hopes or fears or anything. It's just they're just very simplified in what they're doing. One little focus they have. Okay, just sticking with that one little focus. That's what we're doing here. Just a wow. Just a wow. Just this one little wow. And it's more wow than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more wow than expected. Wow. So when the pressure of a golf tournament builds towards the end, you better be really locked into this mental practice and in full blackout mode to all that pressure. Same thing with the world. The world is like we're headed towards the end of the contest of this world. And it's in this, you know, the ferocious pressure now on everyone. And so we need these little techniques. Just say, oh, wow, more wow than more wow than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift is more wow than expected. Wow. So even if you're a really good player, like Spieth, the pressure got to him. It bent him, okay? But he's trying to show resilience and bouncing back. So, okay, the next hole, he almost aced the hole. 210 yards, 6 iron. He's like, what? I need a two hybrid to get 210. He hits a 6 iron. Hits it with speed right on the sweet spot. That helps. So we're hitting the practice on the sweet spot here. More than wow. Frame of reference shift. Wow. Feels more than wow. More than expected. Wow. Feels more than more wow. More than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. Feels more wow. Sorry. Frame of reference shift. Feels more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. Feels more than wow. Frame of reference shift feels more wow than wow. Sorry, frame of reference shift feels more than wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than wow. Than expected, wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected, wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected, wow. A frame of reference shift feels more than expected, wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. And so we're not playing this game of like, yeah, but who's expecting it? You know, the non-dual, the Neo-Advaitin game, like. But you know, what's expecting this? More to who? You know, that kind of stuff. We're not playing that game. That's a game. That's trying to just leap over all expectations, which is gamesmanship. And it seems you may have this relative higher position than others, but you know, is it really God, you know, that you're experiencing? Is it really question, right? So we don't worry about that type of stuff here. That's not it. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. And we don't add anything onto that. If there are those who want to go around the world and talk this non-dual talk, I said, fine, let them do that. If they want to big league us, and if they are big league, fine. Okay, good for them. That's wonderful. But we know what the issue is here and how to address it. The Holy Spirit's shown us very clearly. The real standard bearers are not these Neo-Advaitins. They're like Rama Maharshi, for instance. There's the standard bearer. Are we like that? Then if we're not, we need to reshape our keep working on reshaping our expectations. Really, the experience we will have is inexpressible. You cannot explain it. You cannot explain it. You can't say it's the absence of I, the absence of a person, the absence of a body, the absence of the... You cannot... That's what it's not. You know, you cannot describe it or explain it. So trying to describe it or explain it is a waste of time, really. We should be practicing instead to reshape our expectations. It's more than expected. Wow. It's inexpressible. It's inexpressible. It's more inexpressible than expected. Wow. It's more inexpressible than expected. Wow. Or it feels more inexpressible than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more inexpressible than expected. Wow. Whether it's happening, whether some I is experiencing it or some I is not experiencing it, the experience is still going to be more inexpressible than expected, plain and simple. Whether there's expectations for an I or expectations for no I, the expectations are still there. You know, we're arguing about, well, who's behind the prison bars of expectations? Well, there's no one behind the bars. But the expectations are still there for no one. You know, they're still there. Whether they're there for someone or no one, they're still there. However you want, whatever kind of gamesmanship we want to use with words, expectations are still there. And reality is still expectation-free, you see? Totally expectation-free. So whether it's expectation-free for me, or you, or I, or no I, it's still expectation-free. And we still have expectations, whether it's the I that has them, or the no I that has the expectations, or the self that has them, or the no self that has the expectations, whatever. The expectations are still there. It's the mind has expectations. And you can call the mind no mind if you want to. But the mind still has expectations of no mind, whatever you want to say. The mind is real. You know, we can't get free of the mind by saying the mind, our expectations by saying there's no mind. Of course the mind is real. It's the one that hallucinated the absence of reality. This has got to be a Facebook thing. It is. Oh my gosh. Yeah. I'm always reminded by these posts on Facebook of just how they're, you know, avoiding the practicing. Nice graphics. Nice, beautiful gestures and graphics. And things. Right, okay, fine. they're fans at a big league game, but they're not on the field. All right, so you know, you say, no mind. How does that get rid of all the expectations that have been built up? Saying no mind. We're basically saying, well, all these expectations aren't happening for anyone. They're still there. Experiencing attention, awareness is still expecting this is how experiencing is going to be, whether you call the experience or awareness or no I or no self or I, or there's still experiencing going to take place, and it's experiencing that is shaped by these expectations. So it doesn't matter how you label it at all. That doesn't matter. You can call it the ego. You can say I, you know, ego, frame of reference shift. More beautiful than expected. Our ego feels more beautiful than expected. Wow. Doesn't matter what label you want to use for our experiencing, That's just an attempt to get around practicing. Say, oh, I just got the right label for it. It's not an I, it's now the no I. That's experiencing these expectations. You solved it. Really? So what I saw is that all this non-dual talk has nothing to do with it, actually. It really doesn't. All the spiritual talk doesn't really have anything at all to do with it. What the recognition I had, it's more than expected, plain and simple. There's no way around it. There's no way that any spiritual talk will ever get around this fact. Okay, you could spend a trillion years in spirituality, and it'll still be more than expected. So it's way better to just simply practice frame of reference shift. Wow. It feels more than expected. Wow. That's what'll do it for us. Now, yeah, maybe there are very few in the world at this point who are interested in this. What can I do? I'm not going to change my message just to have more listeners, you know, more those who are involved with doing it, actually doing it, more practicers. I'm not going to change the practice to get more practicers. So I can say, look how many practicers are doing what I advised or something. Can't do that. Yeah. That's a road to disaster. So even if there's no one doing this practice, the message stays the same. The facts remain the same. Worked out a lot yesterday, upper body. You know why people do upper body workouts? Because it I don't know why, it doesn't hurt the next day. It's not so bad at all. I feel like, oh, I feel fine. It's the lower body, the legs and the core, especially the leg, just hurts so bad. It really does. So you see a lot of people, they pump up the upper body, because you can go to the gym and work out your upper body almost every day. You might, you know, certainly every other day. Yeah, absolutely. So I really hit it hard yesterday. Hit my weight. Amazing. I had my weight low really got down to low, and then it shot back up 4 pounds. And in a couple of days, I gained 4 pounds. So, what can I do? It's like that, like a yo-yo. So, you're on this yo-yo, and you just keep trying to trend it downwards. So right now, it's right kind of in the middle, trying to trend back downwards. Again, I feel lighter. I feel better when I feel feel better when I'm a little lighter. I can kind of walk, move better. But I'm still working out. I worked out a lot yesterday in a lot of ways, really great, innovative ways. I keep changing the workout to keep it fresh. Wow, frame of reference shift. Wow, it feels more fresh than expected. Wow, 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 more fresh than expected. Wow. Now, initially, it'll just be words, but at some point, you'll slow it down a little bit, and you'll sort of start feeling it a little bit, maybe. But it's okay. If you don't feel it, keep saying it. It's still effective. The simplicity of it is effective. The focus, our intention, is effective. You don't have to say, well, more fresh than expected. Say, well, I didn't feel the freshness. What's wrong with me? No, the freshness is only felt from the frame of reference shift. So we're trying to get our expectations such that to allow the frame of reference shift to happen, that's when we'll feel the freshness. But it'll be more fresh than expected. Wow. So we're working on expecting more fresh. More fresh than expected. Wow. 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 I feel more fresh than expected. Wow. I feel more fresh than expected. Wow. I feel more fresh. I feel more fresh than expected. Wow. 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 Frame of reference shift feels more fresh than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more fresh than expected. Wow. More fresh than expected. Wow. More fresh than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more fresh than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more fresh than expected. Wow. 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 It's tough to get to this because we want to save face. We're so ashamed of hallucinating the absence of reality, and we're starting to recognize, oh my gosh, I don't want to admit to that, and so we all want to appear more advanced than we are. So practicing like this, the ego, we tell ourselves, oh, I don't need to do that. I didn't hallucinate that much of an absence of reality. I mean, just a little bit, maybe. I don't need, my expectations are pretty much, right on point of what I'm going to experience when I drop hallucination. And so I don't really need to practice. That's only the bad ones who did that. They really went deep into hallucination, But any hallucination of the absence of reality is total absence. You cannot hallucinate a little bit of absence of reality. It's not really possible. Because there's no absence in reality. Reality is never absent from itself. That's its nature. So if you say, well, reality is a little bit absent from itself, that's denying the fundamental nature of reality, totally denying it. Blackout of that, of reality. in our conscious, in our awareness, in our belief. So, but we're so mortified of it that we try to save face by pretending we're more advanced than we are. And we say, so we talk about all these, you know, non-dual stuff, you know, like satsang. I listen to satsangs. I just said right away, I say, that's not it. I don't want to do that. No way. They're not practicing. You know, satsang, someone comes up and says to them, I would say, you know, turn it into a practice. You know, I feel like so other than that. Turn that into a practice. Don't talk. Let's not talk here. Let's turn it into a practice. How are you going to practice that? But people avoid that. I don't know if I've ever seen a satsang where the one holding the satsang said, hey, stop talking. Let's just stop discussing this. Look, you just said something. How are you going to turn that into a practice now? Do it right now. Practice this, and that's it. Okay, you got the practice. Good, go practice it now. Next, you know, like that. That's what should be taking place. Now, in advanced satsang, maybe these satsangs are helpful for those who are beginners, yeah. But, you know, they're trying to save face, you can tell. They're trying to save face, and practicing is beneath them. I'm not that bad, no. You know. It's understandable. We all go through that. But genuine satsang, you know, would be to turn it into a practice. So here, really, you have genuine satsang here. This is really genuine satsang here, actually. But it's not popular, is it? It's not populist satsang. It's genuine satsang. A lot of the stuff in the world is populist satsang for those who, you know, are trying to save face. I got this great guru. I'm talking with the great guru. We're discussing. This is wonderful. I'm really very spiritually advanced. This is great. I don't really need to work on my expectations. They're pretty much all okay just the way they are. And I can go on and live a happy life and, you know, searching after sensory experiences and all these experiences, experiences of manifestation. And that's, you know, that's what God wants me to do, that everything's fine. And I'm talking with this guru, this wonderful guru who really plays the part of the guru so well. And that's populist satsang, you might say. It's popular. It's a way of saving face for everyone without actually making real progress. But that's how they save face, is saying, I don't really need to reshape my expectations. They're not that far off at all. And we all agree, isn't that right, everybody? Yeah. Okay. They all, you know, collective, you know, it's like collective consensus normality. We all agree that we don't need to do the work. Great. Then we don't need to do it. Consensual normality is what, you know, this our effort is. Let's just all have this consensus that, you know, the absence of reality is the new reality, and we don't need to reshape our expectations at all. Easy. Just have to sacrifice those who don't go along with the program. Yeah, but we have the shamefulness of sacrificing Jesus with that, don't we? So Jesus is very helpful. Thank you, Jesus. Whether we like Jesus or not, we should always thank Jesus every day. He's done a lot for all of us. Okay, a lot. Certainly worthy of a thank you, Jesus. Well, again, a lot of people, everyone has mixed emotions about Jesus. Okay, fine. I even do. At times, sure. Yeah, I have. It fluctuates, you know. But I always try to find a way. And even if I don't find a way, you know, thank you, Jesus, because he's done a lot. He really shamed us all. This whole notion of we're fine, you know, with our materialism, sacrificial beliefs. That God's just like that. All we need to do is, you know, just sacrifice God, and then that'll reconcile us to God. Yeah, because now God will believe that the absence of God is a new reality, and there won't be more than expected. We don't have to do anything, work on our expectations. Easy. So that's not too big a price to pay. Let's go sacrifice Jesus, and it's justified. But then we say, wait a minute, did he do anything wrong? And wasn't he just absolutely loving and compassionate and wonderful in every possible way? And we nailed him to a cross? Really? That's nailing it to the cross is reserved for the very worst of the worst. But we nailed him to a cross. Wow, that's so shameful. I don't want to nail him to a cross again. And you know what? Every time we nail ourselves to a cross, to the cross, we're nailing Jesus to the cross. Again. How shameful is that? So, all we have to do to avoid that is just a little bit of practice like this. Your frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. And we keep Jesus off the cross for a second time by just doing that. Because we're not nailing ourselves to the cross, and we are, you know, the brother of Jesus. Do you want, isn't it enough we nailed Jesus to the cross? Now we have to nail Jesus' best friend to the cross, his brother, his sister. We're going to nail them, and Jesus has to watch us nail ourselves to the cross? I think it's enough that we nailed him to the cross. So, you know, why should we have to put him through the agony of watching us be nailed to the cross? That's too much. It's too shameful. So all we have to do is say, frame of reference shift. It feels more than expected. Wow. And we're putting the hammer away. We're putting the hammer and nails away. Yeah, the cross is still there, but we're putting the hammer and the nails away. And we're just standing next to the cross, maybe taking a selfie with the cross. Okay. Put our arm around the cross with a nice cross selfie. It's like, yeah, but we're not nailing ourselves to the cross. Sitting down at the cross, foot of the cross, leaning up, leaning our back against the cross, drinking some vitamin water, toasting Jesus, saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not going to put you through that cross experience of watching me be crucified like you were on that cross. Double shame if I do that. Who really took Jesus to heart? The ones that are refusing to crucify themselves. Double shame. We don't want the double shame. We don't say, hey, if Jesus can be crucified, we can crucify ourselves too. That's the way. That's double shame. We miss the shame of the first crucifixion. The message of the crucifixion is how shameful it was. The resurrection was to say, yeah, folks, did you get the lesson of the shame of that? And Jesus says, I did. I finally realized the shame of crucifying myself. He said just before he died on the cross, he got it, and therefore he didn't really die. He let himself off the cross. But people expected to see him die, so he seemed to be died and buried. But did you get the shame of it? Did you get the shame of it? And I'm leaving this world now for you to work on this, okay? You need to work on this. He says, no, I didn't really deserve it, did I? Nobody deserves it. I'm imperishable spirit. You took me to be something to be sacrificed. You believe that would solve your problems. I'm here to tell you it doesn't. Reality still is life, isn't it? Reality is still eternal life. And here I'm here showing you this is the truth. So you have to work on your expectations. You cannot crucify reality and make it conform to your own crucifixion. So you don't have to do the work of reshaping your expectations. You cannot do that. So try to slip in every day just a simple thank you, Jesus. Doesn't matter if you're Buddhist, Hindu, other or none, or whatever your background is, or whatever you feel your belief, however you want to label your belief system and your efforts and all that. But just slip in there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. He hears you for sure. And he thanks you for not crucifying yourself, you see. And when I met Jesus, I've met him many times, but the time when he came back, announced he's back in the world and said, as a friend, relate with us as a friend, and he said, "Who, you know, who's going to," he's waiting for us to respond, and I finally responded. And then we had a talk, and you know, I lowered myself on the ground, and he lowered himself down, and we both were lying on flat on the ground, facing each other, talking. I said, "No, Jesus, thank you. I want to thank you. I want to thank you." He says, No. I want to thank you." He says, well, okay. He accepted my thanks. He said, "But I'm here to thank you for not crucifying yourself. You see, I'm here as a friend thanking you for not doubling down on shame." I said, "Yeah, but he said, "No, you're doing it. You're not crucifying yourself. So can I hang out with you? I want to hang out with you. You're not crucifying yourself." I like that. I love that. You know. So this is wonderful. This is wonderful. This is what I want to see. I said, What? Spread the news. Spread the good news. Put the hammers and there's a way to put the hammers and nails away. Not by saying the sacrifice worked, but by being ashamed that we even believed that it would work. And being ashamed of our own laziness, refusing to practice in the right way. That's really what we should. We were so lazy, we decided to sacrifice Jesus on the cross instead of doing the practice that we need to do. How shameful is that? So, instead of doing this taping today, I could have been watching that golf in there, but you know what? It was too shameful. And the commercials were all about this, trying to glorify this laziness, you know. Try to glamorize and glorify spiritual laziness. And I said, I can't stomach that. So all because we were lusting after the world. More riches, more advantage over others, more this, that. We forgot to practice in the right way. And then we said, Jesus, I can't be bothered. It's too much. I can't be bothered with that. Let's just sacrifice him. That'll work. That'll conform reality to our expectations. And then hoping, waiting for that to happen. So, no, we know we're okay, God. We don't need to practice. Thank you, God, but we don't need to practice. Jesus sacrificed him. Now we know that reality conforms to our expectations. We don't need to reshape anything. Thank you. You know, that make a religion out of it. Instead of saying, "Hey, God, I do need to practice. Holy Spirit, give me the practice of the day. Let's get on it. More than expected. Wow, frame of reference shift." More, feels more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. Practice of the day, right? Or I could be in there watching TV, you know, being immersed in the glorification and glamorization of laziness. Trusting that sacrificial belief system will work. Well, it works well for staying in hell. Yeah. Works great for that. But we'll never be satisfied with hell. So there's always a fly in the ointment. And more sacrifice is called for to get rid of that fly in the ointment, and it's still there. So more sacrifice is called for. And where do you stop? Well, why don't we stop with Jesus? Let that be the last sacrifice that we make, and let us be shamed by the entire sacrificial belief system, shamed of our laziness. When so simply we could avoid that, we could turn away from this madness, right? So easy. Just frame of reference shift. Feels more wow, feels more than expected wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected wow. So easy and simple. Just a few words here is all that's required. No more sacrifice. No more shame. It's feeling a little warm, warming up a little bit, which is great. Summer should be warm. I love it. We are into the next 4 months is for in California is the dry period, really. It's when things have dried out and gotten hot, and August through November 22nd, you might say, it's the next 4 months. August, September, October, November. Are very dry, very hot, very dry. So everything's going to get dried out here. The effect of the rains of the winter and spring here, we've now reached this point where now it's, you know, going into the heat and the dryness. And, you know, 4 months is a long time. It's going to be 4 months of that heat and dryness for sure. So we're going to feel the teeth of that now, psychologically, the teeth of that. And in the world, psychologically, we're going to start feeling the teeth of the sacrificial belief system is you know, the jackboots are on the cobble, are hammering the cobblestones, there's no doubt about it, right? But we're not interested in that. You know, they are still, you know, shameless, thinking that being shameless, you know, didn't get it yet. They still didn't get what Jesus did. They still don't get that. And what Jesus did is for everyone, of whatever background. He just shamed us all. Shamed us and pointed out our laziness. That's all. Remember, Jesus didn't advocate Christianity. That's a religion that came afterwards. He collectively shamed us all. And we can practice any religion we want to practice. That doesn't invalidate what Jesus did. He shamed us for our laziness. He said, your laziness is what nailed me to this cross. Plain and simple. And I am the one self, as you are. But I'm the one self as normal. Meaning, I've dropped my effort to be abnormal. I'm now the one self without hallucinating its absence. I'm normal. And just because you want to be lazy, you nailed me to a cross. Plain and simple. That's how wicked your laziness is. And so this, and you're going into a sacrificial belief system because of that. This relates to all of spirit. Doesn't matter, you know, whatever religion you call yourself, it still relates directly to you, to all of us. Our laziness is the problem. All of us. Our laziness, our unwillingness to really do what is effective. spiritual laziness. We could be mentally active and chant mantras all day if we want to, or do something, but it's our intention is to feel the more and just realize, wow, this is true. You have to feel that. You have to experience it. You can avoid that by doing all sorts of spiritual practices, all sorts of yoga stuff, and avoid it altogether, real practice. And Jesus pointed out that the Sadducees and Pharisees, that's exactly what they do. It's called spirituality or spiritual materialism. They're avoiding it. It's just, they're just delaying until they think that, until sacrifice works. That's all they do. So how can I pretend to be practicing, but actually just waiting for sacrifice to work? It's called spirituality. When you're actually practicing, you're in this very intense, on-the-edge feeling, frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. And you're directly reshaping your expectations towards this experience that you've had of moreness than expected. So you're affirming the fact that there is reality is present, and there's no escaping it, and it's more than my expectations, right? There's no doubt about it, and it's scary, and so it's shocking. So we're in this sort of shock, and we're blocking the panic of it. So it wears on your nerves. You know, it's not a comfortable feeling. It's not a lazy, comfortable, materialistic feeling. There's some suffering to it. But it's a good suffering. It's the suffering like a workout. When you're doing your reps, you know, like 20, you're like, okay, I feel okay, but 30, and suddenly the burn. You know, you're doing barbell curls, and you've done 30, and you think, well, I'm doing great, but the burn is starting to happen. Uh-oh. And you got to get to 40. Or like I'm doing push-ups, gas station push-ups. I'm doing 55 now, fast. And I'm doing pretty well. And then I get to like 40, which used to be my goal, and I said, okay, that was pretty intense. I said, wait a minute, I got to go to 55. And then it starts getting difficult. You feel the burn, but it's a good burn. You say, I know this is helping me. It's making me stronger. So it's very much like that. It's similarity. Of course, not so similar that you can just do physical workout and forget the spiritual workout. There's a parallel, I would say, but there's not a cross-referencing, cross-effect so much. A little bit in terms of gathering your resolve. Okay. There's a little cross-referencing, but not a decisive one at all. So it cannot take the place of spiritual practicing. Physical exercise cannot take the place at all. But it can help you. It can be sort of a supportive sort of role. But it can never be the central role. It's only supportive. You still have to do all your practicing, spiritual practicing. Yeah, I'm doing 55 push-ups fast, meaning 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, like that, all the way to 55 without stopping. That's when you feel the burn. When you rest, it's amazing that you can go back and do 20 more. You rest a little while, go back and do 20 more. But it's doing it straight like that. Requires the oxygenization. That's when you know you're really getting fit. Are you getting the oxygen to the muscles in an effective manner so you can keep on doing it? It's called endurance. But if you do a few and then stop, do a few more, stop, you're not really getting that oxygenation. It's important to get to the point of the burn so you feel, you know, so you're increasing your oxygenation and metabolism such that you can have this endurance. Same with spiritual practice. We want to get to this burn feeling. We're getting more spiritual oxygen to our expectations. are really getting that oxygen into our expectations, that spiritual oxygen. Wow. More frame of reference shift. Feels more, wow, more than expected. Wow. Feels more than expected. Wow. Feels more than expected. Wow. And just like for me, exercise is really not showing up in how I look very much at all. People just say I look thinner, but they don't say I look muscular or anything. And I don't look that strong at all. I don't get big muscle bulk. I don't bulk up, but I am getting, you know, more endurance. Which is great. So, and spiritually, the same thing. I don't look more spiritual to the world or anything like that. But I'm getting more endurance and doing more intense practices than before. No question about it. So it's getting better. I put on this baggy shirt, and this friend of mine says, If you stood sideways and stuck out your tongue, people would think you're a zipper. Meaning you're thin as a zipper, and then your tongue is the little handle for the zipper. You know, he said that's an old military saying. He said, "Man, what are you doing? You're so skinny. You know, you're losing weight." And I said, "Actually, I'm working out. I feel great, but with a baggy shirt, I don't. I look like I'm just kind of frail and skinny. It's funny." So, again, to the world, you may not seem like anything special at all spiritually, at all. You know, but you're getting better and better and better. Your expectations are getting reshaped in a better and better way. But just wear that baggy shirt so people don't notice. The last thing you want to be in this world is noticed at this point. Forget the you know, the long hair, or the, you know, however you want, the however you appear spiritual to the world, you know, in your dress and in your surroundings and backdrop and your posse and, you know, books and all this stuff. Forget that. That's not where it's at right now. Where it's at right now is for you to be in great shape as far as your expectations go. That is what is important. All that other stuff isn't important. So I just try to, you know, look like I'm just a nobody. Just a very clean-cut, conservative, you know, suburban nobody. Yeah, just fitting in. And so people don't really, they can't really pigeonhole me. No one's able to really pigeonhole me. Like, okay, it's like this, it's like that. And I don't know, I have no idea what people think of me. Nobody's ever told me, really. Because they don't really know. Because the Holy Spirit helps me lay low. Says, dress this way, or act this way, get a haircut. Okay, fine, great. Let's be like that. Just a nobody down in the minor leagues, low minor leagues. Just be like that, a nobody down in the low minor leagues. This is a tradition throughout history. A lot of people throughout history have actually made it. A lot of us have made it just by being very lowly, you know, laborers, or just people that nobody expected anything of them. They weren't chanting in a monastery. They were doing the inner practice that the grace of God suggested, just as they went about their lowly labors. And they just dressed like a laborer. Or, you know, a simple housewife. Poor, simple folk like that, right? That's often the best way. It's often the best way. What I talk about people, sports, nutrition, exercise, a little smattering of this and that, you know, that's about it. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels more beautiful than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels beautiful. How do you say that? You can say more. Feels more beautiful than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift is... Frame of reference shift. Beautiful. More than expected. Wow. So don't think about being called up to the big club, the major leagues. Just sit on the bench in the minor leagues, like this, quietly. In baseball, they have these dugouts, they have these benches with a roof over them, and you know, kind of a railing, wire railing in front. They sit on the benches in between their bats and chewing bubble gum, eating sunflower seeds. They just sit on the bench and. I noticed that I've been chewing a lot of gum recently, and I have to say, it's a bad habit because I find it chewing gum tends to induce a lot of thinking. It really does. You see that people are really nervous and they're really active and stuff. Like chewing gum sort of induces this nervous activity in you. Chomp. So sometimes last night I took it out. I said, wow, this is not good. I got to take it out because every time I chew gum, I start becoming much too mental. It's great for staying awake. Like I chew it when I'm driving, so I stay awake. It's very helpful for that. So if you're doing a lot of driving and you're feeling sleepy, chewing gum, getting that chomp, it really does keep you awake. But if you really want to calm your mind down, it's not good at all. What's our Sunday hangout? Frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. So if you want to be a big leaguer, learn to sit on that minor league bench and just say, frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Just be a great bench sitter. Sit on the sidelines. Be a great sideline sitter. Frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Wow. And when we absent hallucination, it's really a frame of reference shift. It's really a shift. Your whole frame of reference shifts. So we need to recognize it's the frame of reference shift that takes place. It's not our thinking that does it. It's a frame of reference shift that. The light is there, the darkness is off the land. We didn't fix the darkness. We didn't do something to it. We shifted our frame of reference. No more absence of reality. We didn't make the absence of reality more attractive. We shifted our frame of reference. It's a frame of reference shift. It's a totality to it. We shifted off of truth onto off of lies onto truth. We shift off of lies onto truth, off of illusions onto truth. That's a frame of reference shift. Our whole frame of reference shifts. And frame of reference shift feels beautiful, beautiful, more than expected. Frame of reference shift feels serene, serene, more than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift feels serene, serene, more than expected. Wow. So, I better wind it down. I can keep going, but I'm feeling the strain of it. A lot of strain. I don't want to, it's like exercise. You don't want to overdo it. You can if you want to, but I'm pretty good at not overdoing it. Pretty good at it. I'd overdid it once last week and paid a severe price for it. Swung too many golf swings at full, absolute full power, full speed. Too much, and really got hurt badly, the whole spine. And I've recovered from that mostly, but now I'm pretty careful. I take a couple swings and take a break, man. Don't overdo it. So with your exercise, I could do maybe 100 barbell curls, but it, like completely, you know, fry me. I mean, it'd be too much, it'd injure me maybe. So just do a nice healthy dose. I do 40. I think I may up it to 55. In fact, I may do that next, actually. I'll do 55 of them. Yeah, it's time to up the practice dosage to 55. I did that with my push-ups. I can do it with my barbells. I'm going to do that. That's my next step right now, as a matter of fact. Very great. So, the new way is wow, isn't it? The new way really is wow. The new way is all about wow. Frame of reference shift is more than expected wow. Frame of reference shift is more than expected wow. Frame of reference shift is more than expected wow.